Welcome to the first episode of Systems Thinking Theater, the web series that looks at some of our favorite films through the lens of, well, systems thinking. Our first episode will focus on the sci-fi film Arrival, and how it's the perfect film to hang systems thinking on, and showcases how clarity of communication can lead to solving a huge problem. Also, spoiler alert, so if you haven't seen Arrival, do yourself a favor and check it out. We'll be here when you get back. So, to start us off, what is systems thinking? Generally speaking, it's about thinking about how we think. Also known as metacognition, systems thinking aims to solve major problems by understanding how we think. If this sounds a bit abstract, that's okay. Let's get into the film itself to show the various components that make up systems thinking. Major conflicts in systems thinking are identified as wicked problems. In the case of this film, the most apparent wicked problem is the presence of 12 unidentified alien spacecraft floating above seemingly random locations all over the world. It's the driving force of the film, but what comprises a wicked problem? In the book, Systems Thinking Made Simple, wicked problems are identified by five major points. Many interlinked issues cutting across economy, health, and environment. Multiple agencies trying to account for multiple scales. Many different views on the problem and potential solutions. Conflict over desired outcomes or the means to achieve them, and power relations making that change difficult. And the uncertainty about possible effects of action. It's safe to say the dramatic plot point of the film embodies most of, if not all of, these requirements. No one on Earth knows why these spacecraft are here, and the desire to find out will clearly bring about lots of conflict on various scales. We get a very clear view of the conflict within the main characters of the film and the agencies that they represent. The Army, a government agency, brings in linguist Louise Banks, a member of the public sector, to help aid in potentially opening up lines of communication with the alien species. In Arrival, we see the classic struggle between military and science we've seen in many films before. But we also see a bit of a disagreement amongst another character, Ian Donnelly, a physicist who was initially skeptical of Louise's approach to the problem.
Yeah, it's great, even if it's wrong.
It's wrong.
Well, the cornerstone of civilization isn't language, it's science.
This brings us to another important cornerstone of systems thinking, the mental model. Mental models are the framework with which we classify anything we think of. They are the mental snapshot inside of our brain regarding almost anything. Our feelings on pets, religion, food. All of these are great examples of mental models we all have. In Arrival, we have three characters that display their mental models to the wicked problem, as informed by the occupation that they hold. We have Colonel Weber, a member of the US Army. He's willing to give the aliens a chance, but he's also not entirely sure that they're here for peaceful reasons. There's Ian Donnelly, the physicist, who believes the solution for their arrival may lie within numeric patterns or Fibonacci sequences. And then there's Louise, who, as a linguist, believes the aliens may just want to be here to communicate.
How about we just talk to them before we start throwing math problems at them?
This is why you're both here.
Arrival does a great job at presenting these various mental models, showing us how each of these characters perceive the nature of the wicked problem in vastly different ways. So, with the mental models clearly laid out, the Army has in place a system. The team gears up, makes their way into the shell, and initiates contact with the heptapods. However, it takes a critical thinker such as Louise to evolve the process. Louise works to build a line of communication with the heptapods by writing words onto her whiteboard in hopes that the heptapods can communicate with the written word, which results in this. With a line of communication established, Louise and her team can now get to work. They head back to base, they analyze the data, and gain new information, which informs what they will do next inside of the shell. All of this showcases another foundation of systems thinking, the complex adaptive system. Louise creates a list of words to bring into the shell to teach the heptapods. Inside the shell, Louise writes the words out on her whiteboard, which prompts the heptapods to show the correlating logogram. She then takes her team back to base and begins to build a database of words, which then informs what they will teach the heptapods the next time they go into the shell. The system allows for an idea to be tested against real-world stimuli, which in turn provides feedback on an original hypothesis. The system is complex in the sense that it accounts for a variety of outcomes, and adaptive in the way that it informs how to proceed in the future. Despite all this, Colonel Weber still has concerns.
I don't want to take away from your success in there, but Dr. Banks, is this really the right approach? Trying to teach him how to speak and read? That's got to take longer.
You're wrong. It's faster.
What's at play in this scene is what is described as System 1 and System 2 type thinking. System 1 thinking operates automatically and quickly, with little or no effort and no sense of voluntary control. System 2 thinking allocates attention to the effortful mental activities that demand it, including complex computations. System 1 thinking is valuable because, despite it often being wrong, it feels right enough of the time and is faster to achieve as a result. System 2 is more accurate, but takes longer. What Louise is offering Colonel Weber is a mixture of System 1 speed with System 2 results. She explains here in one of the best scenes of the film.
Okay, this is where you want to get to, right?
That is the question.
Okay, so first we need to make sure that they understand what a question is. Okay, the nature of a request for information along with the response. Then we need to clarify the difference between a specific you and a collective you, because we don't want to know why Joe Alien is here. We want to know why they all landed. And purpose requires an understanding of intent. We need to find out, do they make conscious choices, or is their motivation so instinctive that they don't understand a why question at all? And biggest of all, we need to have enough vocabulary with them that we understand their answer.
This embodies yet another systems thinking cornerstone, known as DSRP. Distinctions, systems, relationships, and perspectives are at the basis of any idea. They work constantly in parallel with one another when formulating any thought. A distinction is the presence of an identity and another. The identity of something is also defined by what it is not. A system is something comprised of parts and wholes. Relationships are how various ideas correlate to one another. Every relationship underlies action and reaction. And perspectives are how ideas look from a different point or a view. Just like how people have different points of view, ideas themselves can take different perspectives from one or another. Louise isn't aware of it, but she's actively participating in high-functioning DSRP. Let's break it down and take a look. First off, Louise draws attention to the fact that within the system of a sentence, there is a need to distinguish to the heptapods the concept of a question as represented through the word what, as a means of making request for information. On top of that, there's a need to draw a distinction for specific words in the sentence itself. The word your, as it relates to its use in a specific individual, or for a collective representative of a group, changes given the context that it's used. On top of that, she uses the perspectives rule to imagine from the heptapod's point of view how they may not be able to process the entire idea of a question itself. After these systems are set up and employed, and of course with the help of some perspective changes relating to space and time, and some very well-executed dramatic plot points, the protagonists of Arrival eventually learn the true nature of the heptapod's visit to Earth, thanks to Louise and her effective use of systems thinking. As the film reaches its conclusion, we begin to realize the wicked problem the film provided at the onset was not the true conflict. The real wicked problem was communication. Arrival shows all the ways that lack of communication in times of conflict can be dangerous and cause significant harm. When operating from a perspective of fear, peaceful language seems threatening, and logical lines of questioning and thought suddenly are perceived as weak and indecisive. The systems thinking present in the film Arrival aims to clear up those feelings of fear and allow for a meaningful dialogue. The words we use carry a great weight, and as the film brings up, our communication can be messy. The more we can think critically about it, unclouded from fear or judgment, the more it can help us solve problems of ours in the real world.